The organization of the George Washington Masonic Memorial Association, which built the building that we're in, that association traces its history back to the local lodge here in Alexandria, which Washington became a member of after the War for Independence in 1784. That local lodge here in Alexandria, after Washington died, gathered up and received many Washington-related items from the Washington family and then from the history of Alexandria. And they had a museum that opened here in Alexandria in 1812. And through the 19th century, that museum was a repository and a semi-public museum for George Washington material. By 1900, tourism, the threat of fire, other things, caused the local Freemasons to call a meeting of Freemasons from around the country to form an association to potentially build a larger museum or some sort of memorial to George Washington. So from the lodge grew a committee that grew into an association of Freemasons from around the country, and that association by 1921 had enough money and acquired enough land to start construction of the memorial itself. So the building, the ground was broken in 1922. They raised money and built only as they had the money available. They hired the architect, Harvey Wiley Corbett, from New York City. And the cornerstone ceremony for the memorial was held in 1923. And at that ceremony, President Coolidge, as well as the governor and many other dignitaries, including Chief Justice William Howard Taft, were there, and about 15,000 Freemasons from all over the country came for that ceremony. And then they built the building through the 1920s and dedicated it in 1932, which is the bicentennial of the birth of Washington. So the building was built, the general contractor was a Cranford company, local, and then of course the architects were out of New York, and there were other consulting architects from Michigan. They built, obviously it was a seasonal thing and it depended on what was going on, but I would imagine during the full production, they probably had a couple hundred men on the job site. The building is solid concrete with a granite facade. So they were pouring concrete, and then the stones, the granite stones, were quarried and carved in New Hampshire and then brought down by train to the job site and then put into place. So the exterior is granite, but it's got but the interior is solid concrete. The whole building is solid concrete. So they had a continuous pour of concrete going up through the building over a period of 10 years. Besides the public, and we're open to the public 7 days a week, we do tours 5 times a day. We have various Masonic lodges, local Masonic lodges that meet here. This is their local Masonic Hall. We certainly have groups of Freemasons coming from all over the United States and from all across the country. I think next month we have a group of Freemasons from England coming for an extended visit. It's a sort of a mecca for Freemasons. It's one of the places that Freemasons enjoy to visit. It's one of the great Masonic buildings in the country. But we have, of course, because D.C. is the nation's capital, we have visitors from all over the world, of course, who are in town. And then we rent out the facility for weddings and banquets and concerts and plays. The mission is to educate humanity about the character, the life, George Washington, the man, the father of our country, the Freemason. So what we're really focusing on is reminding Americans and the visitors of the character and virtue of George Washington. One of the things we think about George Washington, of course, we think about him as being an old man, or we think about him being the President of the United States, or we think about him being the Commander-in-Chief during the War for Independence, but we don't think about him as a combat veteran. And we forget that Washington, of course, probably saw more combat than anybody else of his generation. And he spent 5 or 6 years on the frontier in Virginia, in western Pennsylvania, in military expeditions, and leading men into battle. He stepped in front of a friendly firefighter fight to prevent his soldiers from shooting each other. He led men directly into battle. He had bullets shot through him, horses shot out from underneath him. And before he was 26 years old, he had been in combat and seen every aspect of what warfare did, from just simple firefights, but also the killing of innocent people, scalping by Indians, reprisals against Indians by civilians, all sorts of horrible things. And so by the time he did retire from his service during the French and Indian War, and he married Martha Washington, he probably suffered in some way a lot of stress and even what you might, what I would call shell shock or that post-traumatic stress syndrome, because he had seen so much combat. So it's important to remember that he went to war when he was a teenager, and he spent the first 5 or 6 years of his life leading men into battle. And of course, then when he was commander-in-chief during the War for Independence, he of course participated directly into battle, leading men directly into combat, reversing men who were fleeing from battle, taking charge of those units and bringing them back into the line. So we have to remember, besides all of his other characteristics that made him a great man, he had profound physical bravery.